The topic, in fact, I was given full flexibility to choose the topic. I have given lectures in several universities here, Georgetown University in Atlanta and others. And usually my topic has been global financial crisis and why academia in USA is ignoring Islamic finance as alternative paradigm. Even in this period, when there is a financial crisis all over the world, and even keeping in view the fact that intelligentsia in the United States academic world looks for anything which is good to pursue it and to follow it. It is curious that Islamic finance is not being studied very formally. No academic programs are being offered in any university worth mentioning to study this whole phenomenon of Islamic finance. There was a very short news in the media that US Treasury is looking into the Islamic finance as a solution to the current financial crisis faced by USA and the rest of the world. And then after that, there was a blackout. Nothing happened, nobody knows what happened. I saw on the internet that there were some protests that whose system you are trying to study and whatever, what will you gain by this? But probably, I don't know if they are still working or not. But as far as the academia is concerned, it is curious that they are not paying full attention on a formal basis, having courses, having degree programs, despite that there is so much demand for it from all over the world. Europe is taking a lead in it. They are offering PhDs, they are offering master's degrees, they are offering other programs in England, in France, in Germany. But in USA somehow this is not, and there may be reasons, good reasons or bad reasons, but but I'm not now taking that topic. For today I have a different topic. The topic that is more concerned to us, advising ourselves than others. This is what I want to talk about: Islamic finance, the future directions and agenda for research. And I hope it will be more relevant for the Institute, keeping in view its involvement in research and as a think tank. Now, Islamic finance industry is growing globally. We all know this. It has spread in a very short period over almost all corners of the world. London is already a hub. Middle East, we know that there is a big financial market for Islamic finance. South and South East Asia, Islamic finance is very well known and growing. In Singapore and Australia, particularly Singapore is now thinking of becoming another hub compared to London. And even Russia is starting to introduce Islamic banking as a window in major banks. Now, you may not have to copy these things. Those who want, I will email the presentation. So if you don't want to copy, it is okay. But if you want to take notes, it is up to you. So this growth in the industry, that is really very impressive. But let me take a little digression away from the Islamic financing. Just trying to understand what is the Islamic finance and where it stands now. There is one question that have always been in my mind, and it's still there. When did it start, Islamic finance? It started in the late half of 70s. At that time, there were events in Afghanistan. Russia had invaded, and the former Mujahideen were fighting Russia as a second power in the world. And the world was impressed by the commitment of the Mujahideen to Islam and that they are fighting for Islam. And this was a topic of the global scenario at that time. During this, and then there was a retreat of Russia also, which was very surprising for everyone. And during the same period, there was Islamic revolution in Iran, and the big changes were taking place in that country, which was quite a big country in the global scenario. In Pakistan, the military government headed by General Ziaul-Haq, he clearly came up with an agenda to Islamize the economy. And Sudan at the same time also committed to change their entire financial system to conform to Sharia. This is the background in which this movement surged, movement of Islamic finance. People thought that now the resurgence of Islam has come, is on the horizon, and let us do something everybody wants. And they picked up the Islamization of economy as a starting point. The first curious point was that why economic institutions, when they were seeing a resurgence of Islam, so why economic institutions took lead, why it was given priority instead of social institutions? It was curious, but still, of course, it was a good step to start with Islamizing the economy. But while Islamizing the economy, choosing elimination of interest from economy as a starting point, that was very curious. That was more curious. Why to start from this point? Because everybody knew that starting from this point and taking it through to its logical conclusion was not so easy. The Islamic, the financial system and economic system is beyond the control of the national governments. There is so much interlinkages in the economic system and financial system all over the world that to Islamize the economic system or finance system in a country was not very good agenda for the action, or it was not a good starting point. Why, just elaborating on this point, interest, we all know, is just like a cancer, non-curable disease. It has to be uprooted. If it has to be eliminated, it has to be cured, then it has to be uprooted, which is not an easy job. Financial system is determined by, in most of the Muslim countries, by foreign power, by World Bank, by IMF, from where they borrow the money. And more importantly, government needs interest to borrow from public. Government needs money. How can they borrow? Who will give to the government? Interest is a very easy media for them to raise money from the public. People know that 10% they will get every year, so they say, and it is government sovereign country, so it will always be honored. So they easily give the money and government gets the money. If we eliminate interest, what will government do? From where the resources it will get? And those movements or NGOs who were working for introducing Islamization of economy, they come directly in conflict with the government. Because the government thinks that its interests, its main sources for mobilizing the resources for development and for meeting the budget will dry up if they eliminate interest from the economy. It was quite apparent that it was a mission impossible.